Welcome back to a second dose of Breaking Bad. In my first video on this show, I talked about how the second time I watched it, Walter White's transition from Walter to Heisenberg occurred much faster than I had perceived it to occur when I was watching it for the first time. I'd link this sort of distorted perception to a few well-studied cognitive biases, anchoring and the fundamental attribution error. If you haven't seen this video yet, I will link it and I highly recommend it. Part of what makes Breaking Bad so rewatchable is a similarity that it has with The Sixth Sense. In The Sixth Sense, when you watch it for the first time, you don't realize that Bruce Willis is dead, but the storyline is completely consistent and intact. With respect to this belief that he's alive. But when you watch it the second time, knowing that he's dead, despite your interpretive frame being completely different, the story remains consistent and true. In the case of Breaking Bad, when you watch it the first time, you're interpreting everything Walter does through the filter of your positive, wholesome first impression of him. The second time you watch, however, in addition to having that positive first impression anchor, you also have a negative latter impression anchor counterbalancing the former. Because you know where the show is going, you can also pick up quicker on signs that the transition is happening. And as in The Sixth Sense, there were subtle... and not so subtle hints along the way that most viewers wouldn't pick up on until the second time through.
While you're awake? Dead people like in graves and coffins?
Walking around like regular people. We don't see each other. They only see what they want to see. They don't know they're dead.
In Breaking Bad, many of those types of hints directly pertained to chemistry. In the very first episode, there's the dismal scene in which Walter stares blankly at a plaque awarded to him for research contributing to a Nobel Prize as he unenthusiastically exercises on a rinky-dink stepper in a dreary room. This resentment is reiterated in the awkward scene a few seasons later, wherein he is teaching his class about chemist H. Tracy Hall, who, while working for General Electric, discovered a way to synthetically produce diamonds, a discovery of just unthinkable economic value, and yet was only compensated for it with a $10 savings bond. Later in the show, we see that Walter interpreted his compensation for his role in the creation of gray matter as being similarly insulting and in its disproportionality. The next chemical signal that I picked up on was actually in the second episode, where Walter is teaching his students about chirality.
The term chiral derives from the Greek word hand. Now, the concept here being that just as your left hand and your right hand are mere images of one another, right? Identical and yet opposite. Well, so too organic compounds can exist as mere image forms of one another all the way down at the molecular level. But although they may look the same, they don't always behave the same.
Right. For instance, thalidomide. The right-handed isomer of the drug thalidomide is a perfectly fine, good medicine to give to a pregnant woman to prevent morning sickness, but make the mistake of giving that same pregnant woman the left-handed isomer of the drug thalidomide, and her child will be born with horrible birth defects, which is precisely what happened in the 1950s. So, chiral, chirality, mirrored images, right? Active, inactive, good, bad.
When you watch this for the first time, it's easy to interpret it as just being one of the several scenes in which Walter White enthusiastically educates his students about something fascinating in chemistry while they remain uninterested. But the second time through, it's very obvious that this is a case of symbolic foreshadowing. Walter White and Heisenberg are chiral twins or enantiomers of one another. This wouldn't be the last chemical allegory to this set of alter egos, however. Four episodes later, we see Walter teaching his students about mercury fulminate, a highly unstable and thus explosive manufactured chemical compound. Sound like anyone you know? Now, while the show did take some creative liberties in its presentation of mercury fulminate, these liberties were more so cases of embellishments, not George Santos-style flat-out lies. In this clip, we see Walter start out by talking about how a chemical reaction can occur so slowly that you don't even realize that it's happening.
When a reaction is gradual, the change in energy is slight. I mean, you don't even notice the reaction is happening. For example, when rust collects on the underside of a car.
In a second viewing of Breaking Bad, this can be taken as a nod to how Walter himself is undergoing a transformation, but it's occurring slow enough that it's easy not to notice it. Another related interpretation is that Walter's talk of rust on the underside of a car is a metaphor for the resentment that festers below the surface within him. He then talks about how, under significant pressure, the reaction can move from being imperceptibly slow to absolutely explosive. Kind of like when Tuco turned up the pressure on Heisenberg. But for me, the most compelling case of chemical cleverness in Breaking Bad pertains to the invoking of scientist Werner Heisenberg. Heisenberg's most significant contribution was the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which states that we cannot know both the exact speed and the exact location of a particle, such as a photon or an electron, simultaneously. The more precisely we can pin down one, the less precisely we can know the other. How does this apply to Breaking Bad? Well, consider the cat and mouse game between Hank and Walt that ran as a through line for the entirety of the show. From Hank's perspective, when he knows who Walter White is, he doesn't know what he's doing, i.e. he doesn't realize that his brother-in-law is the meth kingpin he has been chasing. But when he knows what he's doing, i.e. being a meth kingpin, he doesn't know who he is, i.e. his very own brother-in-law. This is easily one of, if not the most clever metaphors I have ever seen. The final case of clever chemistry that I'm going to consider actually unfortunately turns out to be a false alarm, but it's so cool that I want to talk about it anyway. It's the name of the final episode, Felina, F-E-L-I-N-A. In addition to being an anagram for finale, some observant viewers picked up on what appeared to be one last chemical signal to the audience. Felina, F-E-L-I-N-A, F-E is the chemical symbol or abbreviation for iron, and iron is an essential trace element in blood. L-I is the chemical symbol for lithium, a metal that can be used in the production of methamphetamine. Perhaps it might even be the most commonly used metal, I'm not sure. And lastly, Na, sodium, a principal element in tears. So some have interpreted this to mean, essentially, Felina, F-E-L-I-N-A, blood, meth, and tears. Like, that is absolutely amazing, I love it, but apparently it's just a coincidence. The title was, in addition to being an anagram for finale, a reference to the song El Paso by Marty Robbins. This song is heard a few times during the Breaking Bad finale. It featured a woman in the song whose name was Felina, and the story within the song bears similarities to the story arc that Walter White goes through in this final episode. So it turns out that the fan theory of blood, meth, and tears was wrong, but it's still so worth mentioning, and it's too bad that it wasn't true, because that would have been next level genius right there. All right, well, that wraps it up for today's video. But before you go, if you picked up on any other clever chemical signals in Breaking Bad that I missed, please let me know in the comment section. If you're new to this channel, take a look around at some other videos. I talk about all sorts of things, ranging from atheism and religion to cognitive science and psychology to politics and the culture war. And I will also continue making content on what popular media can tell us about human cognition. And I will see you next time.